So she goes and goes to Facebook. So she had him in Facebook, and she posted in Facebook. It seems that you're very busy. You're not listening to me. I'm telling you that you go and do your chore. And then he replied in Facebook, okay, mom, I'm going. So how you can be connected to the technology and how you can also influence in positive ways is important. To pay attention to all those social networks.
And going back to the family, something that we did at Grupo Parada was a campaign for the Woodrow Wilson National Fellowship Foundation. And what they do is that they promote STEM, right? So they wanted more, teach more people that were in the STEM professions to take a master's in education, becoming a teacher on that field. So
in the urban setting.
So they had very particular areas that they had, they were able to teach.
They do it in the
world. Yeah, and so they do it in many states in the US, and so they needed more diversity in the number of applicants that they were receiving. They wanted more Hispanics to apply. So an approach that we did for marketing to the students is, yes, we can go straight to the students or the people that are interested in these fields, but we also went through the parents and the family. So then the parents and the family of adults, people that already had graduated with a bachelor's in some type of science, technology, engineering, mathematics, their parents were like, so how do you go about this a scholarship? And they were getting their information in Spanish, and then they were telling their children, their son, they're always gonna be children. It doesn't matter how old they are. So then there's like, yeah, I'm gonna tell my child that he should apply for this. And that's how we got, to increase by 4% the number of diversity applicants that they had. So definitely that's a great connection with the student. Technology plays a huge role, and hey, now the parents are also on Facebook and have all these different technologies.
I feel like technology can play a role, but it can also have a negative impact on, student, because from my experience as a professor, the information is out there, but they don't know where to look. So it's like putting somebody in the ocean that doesn't know how to swim. Go find it. Go find the shore, And I feel like a lot of people, a lot of the younger students especially, they get discouraged because, again, they have these sort of familial obligations. And I find it's worse in the States. We're similar urban setting. It's worse. We're looking at a socioeconomic bar or cohort that has certain obligations. So there's people that are, 17 and they're going to school full-time, working full-time, and then they have a full-time on top of the full-time. And so that's the population that we're serving. But in that essence, I feel like there's no, there's a disconnect. Even though we're connected, there's a disconnect. I sort of would like to see more things geared towards students that can, help them access the information in a better format. So I've been messing around with this app. I don't know if you guys heard of the Scholly app. Has anybody heard of that? Scholly? Okay, I'm gonna tell you about it. It's not my app. I have no connection to it. But these guys, they figured out, these guys were young college students, they were minorities, and it's spelled like S-C-H-O-L-L-Y. And what they did, I actually saw them, I'm gonna say, I admit it, I saw them on Shark Tank. But the thing blew up.
So they influenced, right?
They influenced me, because I was like, oh my God! And the idea is, you go on the app, it's free, you put in what you would like to study, and they hook you up with all the scholarships that are available for you to do it for free. So they give you a list of all the scholarships, deadlines, and all the different programs that are academically available to you as a student. So we're thinking that as something like, oh, that's cool. No, but it's ultra cool. Can you imagine if you were given that opportunity as a young student and you were able to say, you're going to go to school for free, then you wouldn't have, not that you wouldn't have the familial obligations, but it would certainly make you be a better student if you know that that part was taken care of, at least your tuition or whatever it was.
Yeah, and thinking about the loan.
I'm telling you, and it's something so clever.
Yeah.
I happen to be fortunate. I have no student loans. I got scholarship all the way through, and not a lot of people have that. So I didn't have these familial obligations because I wasn't a burden on the home. But a lot of students don't have that, and the information is out there. It's a matter of how do I get it.
I think there's one thing that it's key to understand. We know that, and that's like the second part. We know that technology is not the problem.
Mm-hmm.
We talk about a lot of digital access. I think that one of the problems is digital access. So you have access to the technology, you use the technology,
right.
But do you
really
know how to use
yeah.
the technology when you need to use for a specific purpose? So I think we have to focus a lot more on that. Because that's not a problem. We've been talking about that we don't have, the students don't have access to technology, that's why we don't offer more online courses, that's why we don't use technology, because what's gonna happen if the student doesn't have a connection to the connection? What is gonna happen if students don't have a computer, laptop? But in the study that we showed, there was over 90% of students that said that technology is not a problem, that they have a laptop, they have a mobile device, and nowadays mobile devices are capable enough to be able to allow you to access to all the information that you need. Now, as you said, you have access to all this technology, how do you make sense of it? So being able to get to that, that the other piece, digital literacy,
exactly.
Is key.
And also you you mentioned that the borough, the district or the borough that you that your the hostess is at is also low income, right?
It's one of the poorest districts in the U.S. So even though they showed that there was over 90% no access, they have access.
And following up on that is we have to have in mind is that the second largest search engine in the world is YouTube, right? And something that I have seen in particular is that students also, in order to complement the what they see at school, they're taking courses, is that they go on YouTube and they look at tutorials,
mm-hmm.
right? So they use that as a tool, and Hispanic students are huge video consumers,
yeah.
more than English speakers, more than the other categories. So video is huge. YouTube is a tool that they use that people can use to improve their skills. I mean, people that maybe were struggling, that really helps them. And we're at a day and age that we don't wait for the content. So instead of waiting for the class, we're like, maybe I don't have time because I have family, I have work. So something that in the survey, I really like your survey. So in the survey, they had shown that a lot of the work that they had done for the distance learning class was at work. So
how they did it,
I don't want to know. Maybe we do, but it's also maybe that availability of videos or audio that they can. I mean, the SoundCloud. There's different tools that are both social and that provide that content that students can leverage in order to incorporate that, and it's. Yes, it's about literacy. Yes, it's that they can't find the content. And I think it's also that as institutions, we have to look for ways to make the content easier to find.
Yes.
So it's we can create all this content. Many times we see articles that are like 4 pages long that they post on a blog. But then we have to see, okay, so all that information, how do I break it down in a 30-minute, 1-minute, 10-minute video? You know, and that makes it easier. How do I make it more easier to digest for the student, faster to access? And it's about how do we accommodate both? How do we bring more literacy to the student? And how do we bring more literacy to the institutions as well?
Okay. So what we're hearing then on this technology access, that we can say that the myth of Hispanics not having access is that a myth right now? And I like, on your part, it is, right? So I'm gonna take advantage of people coming from these different parts of the US. What is the situation in South Texas? They're coming from South Texas in the US-Mexico border. And economically, it is a very low socioeconomic status within the US, right?
Yeah.
What is the situation of Hispanics in South Texas as far as technology access?
Going back to the myth of Hispanic not having access to technology, last year we participated in the ECAR survey from EDUCOST, and the whole Rio Grande Valley, 90% of the students have access to technology. It's either a tablet or laptop, and it was about 60% of them have internet at home. So going back to that, expanding that access to technology, it's a myth that this is the regret plan.
Okay, how about our Puerto Rican experts? Do you have any statistics on that?
The sales and marketing executives does a yearly study on on the internet usage, and it has been growing at a steady pace. I think it last year was around 50 something or 60, in that range, so between 50 and 60%, but mostly was from mobile devices, cell phones, and public access or Wi-Fi phones.
No. So the second thing is Hispanics have access, and number two, mobile could be the best way to access them.
Sorry. I wanted to add, like in my city, McAllen, what they did is the ISD gave tablets to all the students.
The ISD is the independent school district, the school district.
So K-12, all students in that system got an iPad as part of the curriculum. So, and they came from a Bill and Gates foundation.
We also have it available and shared at the independent school district too, where the students have access to tablet PCs that they can take during the school district. And they're fully loaded with the free Wi-Fi that they don't have to worry about. The Dawson School District as well in the Northern Valley. So that's a plus to where they don't have to worry about it. They can do their homework at home, not having to worry about the Wi-Fi.
There was a study 1 or 2 years ago that indicated that the trends on mobile users, Hispanics, were higher than any other group in the U.S. So consumers, video consumers, and just having access to mobile devices is way higher than any other.
New York City, there's an arrangement being made through the New York Public Library that they're going to be giving Wi-Fi hotspots to families that don't have access.
And something about tablets too is that they're very, and mobile devices overall, they're very user friendly. So they're actually the door to, you know, increasing that technology literacy, both for children, as you had mentioned, and for adults as well. I mean, my mother, she knows more what's going on Facebook than I do. You know, so I gave her the laptop. She doesn't know what to do. She's like, wait, how did I do this again? But she grabs my tablet and she grabs her cell phone.
She knows
she's
getting married.
She's
engaged.
I get the whole info when I get home. Yeah. So yeah, I'm talking about communication, right?
And I haven't simplified the message, so you need to do the
yes.
Get a simplified message.
Exactly.
Okay. Any other comments about technology?
I want to mention that, jumping back a little bit for the topic that he mentioned about the student in terms of the use of the technology versus the services face-to-face. In our case, we bring a lot of opportunity for access to our student hotspot, Wi-Fi areas, and the students still using the face-to-face services. Less than 50% of our students use online services to get information and to receive the student services, and we provide a lot of student services online, and the students prefer to go to the student service center and ask for the services face to face. I think this, I don't know what is the experience at other people in the mainland with the student, but also we provide a new student portal that have a lot of opportunity to access services and other information, and they prefer to call. Go directly to the, and it's very interesting. It's not a problem of access here in Puerto Rico.
Maybe they use Facebook for the online face to face.
And something that was shown on the survey was that most of the connection with faculty was through email. Now email you answer a lot on your cell phone too, but also that it was very low on the response rate, maybe 6%. Both for text messaging and for video conferencing as well. How many, by the raise of hand, have in their institution some type of video conference that you could do, you know, student answer student questions?
How do you use that?
Our call center have many opportunities to chat with the services officers that provide services there. They have a chat room, but the students don't use it. The traditional way to communicate.
You know, one of the results we showed is that it was the second highest was actually that students would use office hours from faculty. The students that were taking online courses, they wanted to use office hours with faculty. That comes also with culture, we mentioned also the learning styles. that students have, so that I prefer to be more visual or being able to have that contact with having that direct conversation. Or I prefer consuming videos is also another indicator of learning styles. And that's not necessarily specific to Hispanics, it's a student in general, but being able to know what type of learning style students have will allow me to be able to cater my content, how I'm presenting this content, and how I am adding all the different elements. YouTube videos, you don't need to create, so nowadays you don't need to create additional resources. You don't need to reinvent a video that you could identify. And you are the knowledge expert, the one that is going to be able to filter and identify that this element will actually be helpful for students to look at. We have that knowledge.
You can create a playlist.
So you create a playlist, and then you allow for those students that are not regular text-oriented learners, but more visual learners, that to be able to grasp the same content. And then you will see a difference on how they will interact. It's not that they're not good students. It's not that they cannot learn the content, but it's just that they had another style to learn the content.
It's interesting, I made the same observation. The department that I work for is Academic Support Center, so I work with everybody, tier one, tier two, tier three. And it's very interesting because one of the services that we offer is Skype tutoring. And so it's just wherever you are, mobile, you can connect with the tutor. Well, it's very interesting because as you said, depending on your learning style and your comfort level, some students frown upon it and they would rather still come for the on-site tutoring. And it's quite interesting because sidebar, this is Dr. Barral and I work for Berkeley College. And what we did was we did a study on helping students to identify their learning style. And through that, we were able to help them find ways to process this information. So I think it does go back to not only having ways for them to gain access to this technology, but then as you said before, how do I break this down and internalize it so I can then go back and apply it?
Wait, what's that? A comment right there?
Yeah, that's something that we did in terms of providing services to students via online. Two initiatives. We got the around campus. We launched some. We set up some kiosks for information, so students can even be advised through that via video conferencing. So
the kiosk has video conferencing.
They have video conferencing. It was launched at the Brownsville campus, but yeah, it has all the and it has a menu on it. And it's dedicated for student services only. What was the other which you did? We have. Also work with advising, academic advising, because a couple of years ago it was a mandatory advising for every single student, but they didn't have enough advisors and there was enough time, or there were some students that were working and advising was open only to 5 or 7 o'clock. So what we did is we incorporate Blackboard Collaborate on it and then the Blackboard IM. So because in the IM, we know that, or we knew that the students were actual students because they were accessing it through Blackboard. Mm-hmm. And if you access that through Blackboard, that means that you're a current student. So security and everything was embedded on it, so that was the other I guess, initiative.
And going back to the family as well, and this has to do with the need. Now, family also means community, right, for us as Hispanics. And many times, if you're on an online course, or you know, like me, for example, when I went to school, I had to go to evening classes because of work, and I had that yearning, that need to go to the place, the university. So maybe it could be also that need to have that contact, that personal contact, as part of our culture. To get that interaction, to be part of that community of the college, and then you know maybe it's a combination. Maybe it's also what does the platform really cover? Does it adapt really to the needs of maybe Skype doesn't have as much flexibility as maybe Google Hangout might have, right? So you know there's different variables that. And with technology, it's always about testing, right? You're never going to have the straight answer, and it doesn't apply to everybody, so you're going to have to see and adapt what works with the different types of personalities.
And just don't expect that the technology will be so
solving the problem.
The fantasy.
Technology is just a tool. And depending, the results depend.